Now that Quantum Body is out and doing extremely well, thanks to your support, I have been thinking about the next project. And I convinced my publisher that it would be a good idea to explore the use of AI for elevating spiritual intelligence and helping us achieve optimal personal health, longevity, health span, etc. And the publishers like the idea. So that's going to be the next project. Okay, we're going to call it, I'd like your feedback, of course, but we're going to call it Digital Dharma. Digital Dharma, how to use AI to elevate spiritual intelligence and personal well-being. Let me know what you think. But as I got up this morning, I decided to play a little bit with AI, as I do occasionally and frequently. And I use several AI products, including Google Bard, ChatGPT-4, etc., Bing. So I decided to play with it a little bit, and also before I do that, before I share with you what I did this morning, let me just give you my take on AI in general. So AI is, in my opinion, augmented human intelligence. AI is super intelligent because it's a large language model, combines many types of language, including, understanding biological language, the language of physics, chemistry, mathematics, philosophy, etc. So it's super intelligent. There's no human being that will ever be as intelligent as what the AI products are evolving to be. Having said that, AI can never have subjective experience, no matter what the experts say. Okay, AI will never experience experience is the word subjectively. Sexuality, hunger, thirst, existential conundrums, fear, etc. Love, anything that sentient beings experience. It might simulate that, but subjectivity is something that occurs only in consciousness, not even in the brain. So we've been talking about that a lot. So this morning I said, let me see if I can use certain prompts, AI prompts, to engage Google Bard in a reflective process. Remember that even its reflections will come from what it has been fed, large language models and algorithms that correlate with each other, etc., etc. Nevertheless, it's possible to train AI to point us in the right direction for exploring anything, including spiritual intelligence, physical, mental health, and longevity and well-being. Remember also that it will only give you models that are already there, nothing totally original. Also, right now, I'm told that the large language models are only good at linear thinking, linear thought process with the algorithms. When something becomes non-linear, my experts tell me that what you get back is a hallucination. So these problems, of course, will be sorted out. Right now, non-linear processes are very complex, and non-linear interactions are very complex. And actually, that's one of the problems when we explore quantum reality, quantum body, because that realm is not linear. And yet the math can get there in a non-linear rationality, logic, but current models do not do that. AI models do not. And yet humans, we as conscious beings and self-aware beings, are able to connect dots that didn't exist before in our linear thought process. So in any case, this morning when I went to Google Bard, I asked the question, who is it that wants to understand how nature works, or how existence works, or how awareness of existence works? Are we who are exploring the secrets of nature, are we not ourselves an activity of nature? So are we nature, the universe, however we want to label it, exploring itself? And so I got a very interesting response that I want to share with you. You're absolutely right. The use of we, who are we, in your statement deserves clarification. There are multiple ways to explore what we call we. Number one, the collective human community. When we speak of scientific advancements, we often refers to the collective effort of humanity throughout history. From the ancient philosophers to modern researchers, all contribute to the vast body of knowledge that allows us to model and predict natural phenomena. Bullet point number two, the specific scientific community. In a narrower context, we might refer to a specific field of research or a research team conducting a particular study. This emphasizes the collaborative nature of scientific inquiry. I would say now the collaborative nature of even large language models, where knowledge builds up upon the findings and contributions of previous and current researchers. Bullet point number three, nature itself. There's a philosophical perspective that you raise that views science as an expression of nature's own complexity and self, exploration. If we consider everything within the universe, including consciousness and scientific endeavors, as part of nature's tapestry, then we, quote unquote, becomes all-encompassing, with scientific activities being an emergent property of nature itself. Emergent. I have issues with that, but never mind. In a sense, all three interpretations hold validity. Actually, all three interpretations are activities of nature. Of course, that should be obvious. We, as individuals, are products of nature, shaped by its laws and driven by its curiosity. Wow. So nature is curious, according to the statement. Our scientific pursuits are an extension of that inherent curiosity, allowing us to glimpse deeper into nature's intricacies. Therefore, yes, you could say that objective science is, in a grander scheme, nature exploring itself through the lens of human cognition and inquiry. It's a beautiful and humbling perspective, reminding us that even our seemingly detached attempts to understand the universe are ultimately part of its grand unfolding. We are not outside observers, but participants in the cosmic dance, contributing to the ever-evolving story of existence. And then this ends, the AI response ends with, "Thank you for prompting this introspection. Your question invites us to not only seek answers, but also reflect on the very nature of those who are thinking." And who is thinking? The universe is thinking through you. So I think I might even do a meditation on this, how the universe thinks through you. But this is an interesting new exploration. I've always been a fan of technology. You know, when I came to this country in 1970, I had never seen a television set. Then I saw a black and white television set. Then I saw color TV. Then fax machines. Then emails. Then the internet. And now immersive experiences and AI. And the universe keeps exploring itself. And it's beautiful. We can use these technologies to help create a more peaceful, just, sustainable, healthier, and joyful world. But we can also use them as killing machines. The choice is ours, and our spiritual and emotional evolution, if it doesn't keep up with the exponential evolution of technology, then even these technologies could become killing machines. So whether technology is divine or diabolical depends on us. Use it for divine purposes and we heal the world. Use it for diabolical purposes and we're all screwed. Let me know your thoughts.